This is the story of Pocahontas. Let's begin now. The journey began like any other. Captain John Smith stood on the deck of a sailing ship bound for the New World. Once at sea, the ship was almost lost in a storm, and Smith had to rescue one of the men. But he did not even think of turning back. Danger and adventure came along with the territory. It was the part of every voyage he enjoyed. Now he was headed for a dazzling land that this crew, the Virginia Company settlers, and Governor John Ratcliffe wanted to conquer for king, country, and gold. But that dazzling land was already home to many people. Among them was Pocahontas, the daughter of a native chief. With Miko, a raccoon, and Flit, a hummingbird, Pocahontas loved running through the forest and diving off the cliffs into the pools below. She also loved canoeing with her best friend, Nakoma. She told her everything, including a dream she kept having.
I know it means something, I just don't know what. You should ask your father about it.
Pocahontas hurried back to her village. She found her father in his longhouse and told him about the dream.
I think it's telling me something's about to happen, something exciting.
Chief Powhatan smiled.
Yes, something exciting is about to happen. Kokuom has asked to seek your hand in marriage.
Marry Kokuom?
Pocahontas could not imagine marrying the brave but serious warrior.
Father, I think my dream is pointing me down another path.
Pocahontas, you are the daughter of the chief. It is time to take your place among our people.
Pocahontas left her father and went to her favorite glade to get advice from a wise, enchanted tree. She called this tree Grandmother Willow.
My father wants me to marry Kokuom, but lately I've been having this dream.
Then she told Grandmother Willow about the arrow that she kept seeing.
As I look at it, it starts to spin. It spins faster and faster and faster until suddenly it stops.
Now the old tree spoke.
Well, it seems to me this spinning arrow is pointing you down your path. All around you are spirits, child. They live in the earth, the water, the sky. If you listen, they will guide you.
As Pocahontas strained to hear the wind, that same breeze filled the sails of John Smith's ship and carried it to shore. Inside the governor's cabin, Ratcliffe gave Smith an ugly look.
About the natives, I'm counting on you to make sure those filthy heathens don't disrupt our mission.
He didn't add that finding gold in the New World was his last chance for glory in the king's court. Smith cocked his head and grinned.
Well, if they're anything like the savages I've fought before, it's nothing I can't handle.
Already those so-called savages had seen the ship and rushed to meet with their chief. Powhatan raised his hand to silence them.
We must know more about these visitors.
Kikata, what do you see?
The medicine man poured some powder on the fire.
They prowl the earth like ravenous wolves, consuming everything in their path.
Kokuom wanted to lead an attack.
We will destroy these invaders the way we destroyed the Massawomics.
Kokuom, in that battle we knew how to fight our enemy, but these pale visitors are strange to us. Take some men to the river to observe them. Let us hope they do not intend to stay.
But the settlers did intend to stay. As they set up camp, Governor Ratcliffe barked out orders.
You men build the fort, and you start clearing this blasted shrubbery. The rest of you, break out the shovels. It's time to start digging.
While most of the settlers began digging for gold, Smith scouted the area for the people the English called Indians. From a tree on a hilltop, he surveyed the view. The land was beautiful. A moment like this, he thought, is exactly why he had traveled so far. Then Smith spotted the shadow of someone following him. he hid behind a waterfall. The shadow passed, and he leaped out with his rifle raised. It was Pocahontas. They both froze. Smith lowered his gun, and she ran for her canoe. Catching up with her, Smith gently held out his hand.
I'm not going to hurt you.
Pocahontas gazed into the strange blue eyes of the man, trying to understand what he was saying. As the breeze picked up and leaves swirled around them, Pocahontas followed Grandmother Willow's advice. She listened with all her heart, and it seemed that the wind was telling her to go ahead and take the man's hand. So she did. All at once, it was as if she understood his words. She pointed to herself.
Pocahontas.
The man smiled back.
John Smith.
As they walked together, teaching each other about their different customs, the scavenging Miko stole a compass from Smith's pouch. Smith told Pocahontas that it came from London, a very big village filled with carriages and bridges and big, tall buildings.
I'd like to see those things.
You will. We're going to build them here. We'll show your people how to use this land properly, how to make the most of it.
Pocahontas glared at the Englishman.
Make the most of it?
Yes. We'll build roads and decent houses and...
Our houses are fine.
You think that only because you don't know any better. There's so much we can teach you.
Meanwhile, the settlers were growing tired and unhappy. They couldn't find any gold. And worse yet, they were running out of food. Then Radcliffe caught the Indians spying on the settlers.
Savages! It's an ambush! Arm yourselves!
As shots rang out, the surprised Indians fought back with their bows and arrows. During the battle, Radcliffe shot a warrior in the leg. Cocoam rushed out to rescue his wounded comrade and carried him back to the village. In the forest, Pocahontas suddenly heard the beat of war drums coming from her village. She said goodbye to Smith and hurried home. There she learned that one of her people had been shot, and warriors were coming from other villages to help fight the invaders. Even though this saddened her, Pocahontas could not stop thinking about Smith. The following day, as the others built a wall around the village, Pocahontas and Nakoma gathered corn in the fields. When Smith suddenly appeared, Pocahontas thrust a hand over Nakoma's mouth.
Please don't say anything.
Then Pocahontas heard Cocoam calling her.
Pocahontas!
She grabbed Smith's hand.
Quick, this way.
Leaving Nakoma behind, Pocahontas took Smith to the glade. Smith learned from her that Radcliffe was wrong. The Indians were not hiding any gold. Pocahontas introduced him to Grandmother Willow. Suddenly, they heard a pair of settlers calling,
Smith! Smith!
He glanced at Pocahontas.
We can't let them see us.
Quick, over here.
Grandmother Willow motioned with her eyes, and Smith and Pocahontas hid behind the tree. After the men left, Smith gazed at Pocahontas.
I'd better get back before they send the whole camp out after me.
Then they promised they would meet later that night in the glade. As Smith ran off, Pocahontas peered up at Grandmother Willow.
I shouldn't be seeing him again, but still, something inside is telling me it's the right thing.
Perhaps it's your dream.
Do you think this could be my path?
Grandmother Willow just smiled. When Pocahontas left the glade and returned to the village, she saw that the warriors had arrived. Quickly, she pulled her father aside and begged him not to fight the Englishmen.
Sometimes our paths are chosen for us.
But maybe we should try talking to them.
They do not want to talk.
But if one of them did want to talk, you would listen to him, wouldn't you? Wouldn't you?
Of course I would, but it is not that simple.
He turned and strode into his longhouse, where the council of warriors was waiting. While Pocahontas was trying to reason with her father, Smith was back at the settlement, trying to convince Radcliffe not to fight the Indians.
They're not savages. They can help us. They know the land. They know how to navigate the rivers. And look, it's food.
He held up an ear of corn that Pocahontas had given him. But when he told Radcliffe that there was no gold in the area, Radcliffe exploded.
Lies! Lies! This is my land! I make the laws here. And I say, anyone who so much as looks at an Indian without killing him on sight will be tried for treason and hanged.
So the day wore on, and both sides prepared for war. But that night, Pocahontas and Smith stole away and met in the glade.
Maybe it's not too late to stop this. You have to come with me and talk to my father.
As Smith protested, saying that both sides actually wanted to fight, Grandmother Willow interrupted.
Look.
She dipped one of her branches into the river. Pocahontas pointed.
The ripples.
Grandmother Willow smiled.
So small at first, then look how they grow. But someone has to start them.
Smith looked at Pocahontas.
Let's go talk to your father.
With joy, she threw her arms around him. As Smith and Pocahontas kissed, Thomas, who had been ordered by Radcliffe to trail Smith, stepped from behind a bush. A second later, Cocoam burst into the glade and tore Smith away from Pocahontas. The warrior pulled out a knife, but before he could wound Smith, Thomas took aim and shot Cocoam in the chest. Pocahontas lunged for the settler.
He killed him!
Smith stopped her.
He was only trying to protect me.
Then they both heard the shrill cries of the other warriors. Smith whirled upon the settler.
Thomas, get out of here!
As Thomas dashed into the forest, the Indians swarmed into the glade and captured Smith. In shock, Pocahontas watched them leave with Cocoam's body and the man who they thought had shot him. Pocahontas knelt by the riverbank and wept. When Pocahontas returned to the village, she was horrified to learn that Chief Powhatan had ordered Smith to be executed at sunrise. Later that night, Nakoma helped her friend slip past the guards and enter Smith's hut. Pocahontas ran to the Englishman.
It would have been better if we'd never met. None of this would have happened.
Pocahontas, look at me. I'd rather die tomorrow than live 100 years without knowing you.
Meanwhile, Governor Radcliffe was stirring up the settlers.
I told you those savages couldn't be trusted. Smith tried to befriend them, and look what they've done to him. But now I say it's time to rescue our courageous comrade. At daybreak, we attack!
Yes!
Powhatan, as well, was preparing his men for war. He reminded them that they had no choice but to fight the invaders, who were nothing more than greedy, murderous savages. Before she could be discovered in the prison visiting Smith, Pocahontas kissed him goodbye, then retreated to the glade. Trying to comfort her, Miko gave Pocahontas Smith's compass. As she looked at it, the needle started to spin.
It's the spinning arrow!
Grandmother Willow beamed.
You know your path, child. Now follow it.
As the sun rose, Pocahontas followed the arrow to a plateau. She saw her father raise a club above Smith's head and threw herself across the prisoner.
If you kill him, you'll have to kill me too. I love him, father. Look around you. This is where the path of hatred has brought us.
Powhatan followed her gaze. He saw the settlers at the edge of the woods ready to shoot, and his own men, with their bows pulled taut, ready to fire back. He knew he had to make a decision.
My daughter speaks with a wisdom beyond her years. Release him.
The warriors lowered their weapons, and then, against Radcliffe's orders, so did the settlers, moved by Powhatan's act of goodwill. Enraged, Radcliffe tried to shoot Powhatan, but Smith knocked the chief out of the way, taking the bullet himself. Instantly, the settlers captured the greedy, dishonest governor and put him in chains. The next morning, Smith lay on a stretcher, forced to return to England for treatment of his wound. Just before the ship was to leave, Pocahontas, her father, and her friends arrived. Smith asked her to come back with him. But Pocahontas knew that she had to stay behind and help keep the peace. She gently kissed the English captain.
No matter what happens, I'll always be with you. Forever.
And then they parted, each hoping that someday their paths would cross again.